I managed to land okay, tumbling over when I hit the ground and the chute collapsed without dragging me. The uniformed German soldiers, who had been following my descent, rushed up to me as soon as I hit the ground. At the time it seemed unreal, and here they were, just like a scene from a movie. It became real enough though, when my arms were grabbed and my revolver taken away. Holding tight to my left arm was an elderly soldier.
He's shouting at me and I look at him and he goes like this.
And unmistakably indicating with gestures that they were going to hang me.
I don't know whether to be scared or what, and I feel a tug on my right arm.
My right arm was held by what seemed to be a 15 or 16 year old soldier.
He looks at me and he goes,
as if to say, don't pay any attention to him. You're not gonna hang. This was a most generous and welcome assurance, which I will never forget.
That's a memorable experience.
I was taken to a police station, which had served as a local occupation headquarters.
And kept there for a couple hours while I was rounding up any number of aircrew that had been shot down in the area. There was 160 planes in that armada, so there were quite a few prisoners.
A truck then took us to a small town to be transferred onto a bus. The townspeople smiled and waved at us, but the guards made them stop. We were driven to a schoolyard in Krakow, where we were held surrounded by guards. We were kept apart from a group of Russian prisoners. I tried to make signs of comradeship with them, and waving when the guards weren't looking.
Having come from a Russian immigrant family, and familiar with Russian songs, etc., and Meadowland was popular one. I tried to whistle Meadowland, but the Russian prisoners were very suspicious, so no one acknowledged my attempt at all.
They were deeply suspicious and didn't respond. I doubt they ever survived. The Germans either killed them or worked them to death. While in the open yard, we were dismayed one day to see several experimental German jet bombers fly by at what seemed to us at the time an incredible speed. Their exhausts were dark, probably a poor fuel that eventually developed for jet engines. None of us had seen a jet before, and we were alarmed at the threat that this innovation posed to our side.
From there, we collected more and more POWs, and they put us on a train.
They marched us through Krakow to a railroad station. The prison train carried us through Breslau, Dresden, Leipzig, Schweinfurt. As we passed through the train yards at each of these cities, we could see the results of some of our bombing raids.
We got to an interrogation center at Frankfurt.
We finally arrived in darkness at the main interrogation center for captured Allied flyers. Under the glare of large searchlights, we were brought into the complex and were placed in individual solitary cells. When my cell door was slammed shut, the feeling of something dreadful likely to occur was inescapable. For 5 days I was held in a tiny cell, uncertain of my fate, aware of my vulnerability as a Jew. One could hear the door slamming and an occasion of a shot would ring out.
I was in solitary and hungry. They gave me a slice of the equivalent of pumpernickel, and I thought it was something like cream cheese. It was lard, which I never had. A thick layer of white lard. I was perfectly okay. I was so hungry.
Yeah.
Right? So that's what I had, an ersatz coffee, which is made out of chicory and beans.
My first encounter with the interrogating Nazi officer was intimidating. He wore a swastika armband, and behind him was a huge swastika flag. He spoke with an American accent and used occasional slang expressions. When I refused to give him more than my name, rank, and serial number, he reminded me I could be shot as a spy. He then shocked me with the vast amount of information the Germans already had about me. In any event, I was no more cooperative and placed back in my cell for a few days.
I'm proud of my performance. I was aware of the fact that Jews were being collected and emptying out in countries that the Germans took over.
One evening, my cell door was opened and a guard escorted me down a hallway, out through a courtyard, and up a flight of stairs in a separate building.
I was brought into this room on the second floor.
In the room were five high-ranking officers in uniform, the least of them the equivalent of a major colonel.
Swastika armbands, a big portrait of Hitler and a flag.
Nearby was a table laden with mouth-watering food. The first words from the Germans, in perfect English, without a trace of an accent. You must be hungry, Lieutenant Canin. Why don't you help yourself? I instantly felt responsibility, as a Jew, not to reinforce any of their ideas of stereotyped Jewish behavior. If they expected to witness a glutton attacking their food, they're going to be disappointed. I replied, no thanks, I've had sufficient food.
He says, Lieutenant Canin, you may be curious as to why you're up here. I said nothing.
Nazis. You see, we seldom find any Jews actually doing the fighting. They always manage to get others to do that for them.
At this point, I felt, whatever they're going to do to me, they're going to do to me. I'm not going to just be a wimp. So I had the courage and the temerity to think, I'm not going to give them any satisfaction. If they think I'm going to reinforce their stereotypes, screw them. So I said, I don't think that's the case. I said, I have gone through training. Many of us were Jews.
Nazis. You must have heard of some jokes about our leader.
Have you heard any jokes about our Führer? I said, I'm sure I have, but I've forgotten them. That was a good discretion.
After this informal banter, they finally arrived at what I thought was the main reason for having me there.
They said, we know you were a radar navigator. They said, we're curious about your training. How'd you learn to perfect your skills?
If I told them nothing, might I not be turned over to the SS and ultimately broken into telling them anything they wanted to know?
There's no way that you could resist indefinitely. They'll just increase the variety of torture. What I felt is, I'm not going to tell them, also I screw it, I'm going to really give it a little jab.
I gave them a complete fabrication that we are perfecting our skills by many hours of flying over various types of terrain in populated areas in order to become completely familiar with images on our scope.
An absolute lie, because I trained for hours in a simulator.
I assume my answer satisfied them, since they resume with political questions. Nazis. Who do you think will be the victor in this war?
And I said, I think our side is moving forward and victory is in our hands. I didn't feel any sense of bravado or anything else like that. I just felt I was in control.
That apparently ended their interest in me. Needless to say, there was no cordial good night.
No goodbye or anything, no thank you. But at least they didn't kill me. I think I did my share. So yes, I think of that very often, and it's an indelible memory.
September 25th, we boarded a train to bring us to Stalag Luft 1. The camp was set up to hold captured American and British flying officers. By the end of the war, there were 10,000 of us there. I spent 8 months here as a prisoner of war. It was a dramatic and impressionable period in my life and had a lasting effect on me. To the good, I believe. Stalag Luft 1 was no club med. We were under constant surveillance with guard towers, roaming guards, barbed wire fencing, and attack dogs at night in the compounds. The Luftwaffe ran the camp. There were 2 outdoor roll calls a day, often in freezing weather, snow, or rain. My shoes never seemed to dry. Food was minimal and unpredictable. Our barracks were poorly built wooden structures. 18 of us shared the 14x30 room. The day was spent in whatever way each Kriegi, or POW, found best to overcome boredom or anxiety. The American YMCA had given each of us a blank diary. I decided to keep a record of events, complete with illustrations. In my diary, I also did pencil sketches of each of my 17 roommates, with a brief narrative accompanying each sketch. The personality, hobbies, and terror story, how they were shot down and wound up here. Needing some watercolors, I approached one of the older guards and offered him either cigarettes or chocolate in exchange for paints and a brush. I must have been observed.
I walked a couple yards and someone taps me on the shoulder. He says, you ought to come with me.
I was summoned to our own senior American officer for reprimand and a warning.
They said, if you ever do that again, you'll be court-martialed. You have to know that there are only a few of us who are designated to trade with the Germans. We have clandestine radio, we have clandestine printing capability. So be warned, you'll be in real serious trouble if you ever even talk to a German guard. That was it.
Eventually, I did get some paints from the Red Cross. I improvised a brush using some of my own hair. Aside from illustrating my own diary, I soon found I had a marketable commodity illustrating the diaries of some of the other POWs in exchange for Red Cross parcel items. I soon acquired a nickname, Remy, for Rembrandt.
None of us could take any credit for the very clever things that were already organized. They talk of American ingenuity. I've never seen it in practice as intensely as I saw it there. Someone came up with the idea of like adult education. If you were a decent guy who wanted to help out and you were trained as an insurance salesman before the war, or teaching a language, it would be spread around where to go to find this guy. The choices available with these do-it-yourself teachers. I took up chicken farming.
There were no rooms, no grades, just an informal way to keep the mind active.
So we had a stock exchange, we had a news, we had the schools, we even had a group who put on plays. I only remember one play while I was there, The Man Who Came to Dinner, and it was beautifully performed.
When we got up the morning of May 1st, we found the guards had fled. They were probably rushing to the west to surrender to the Americans or the British, rather than be caught by the Russians. We are in control of the camp. Contacts had been made successfully with the Russians. In a day or so, several of their officers rode up in a jeep to confer with our senior officers. More uniformed Russians soon arrived to help with the logistics of returning us to our countrymen. A Red Army entertainment troupe arrived to present a marvelous show of ethnic dances with appropriate costumes and accompanied by Russian music. With my parents being Russian-born, many of the melodies were quite familiar to me. It was an emotional experience, a real class act. And by the time we reached home, I was okay. I was sent to Atlantic City for rest and recuperation, and subsequently received my discharge papers plus separation pay, which had been accumulating.
The prison camp experience in general has a very, very strong effect on my life thereafter. I determined that if I could survive this, I want to have as much of a peaceful life I can, avoiding conflict, and if I can set an example of surviving a stress situation. So that's the story.